What's up? What's up? It's Heit the Great, as some people call me. We are here today and we are going to talk about the military's relationship to hip hop, or hip hop relationship with the military. In other words, the impact of the military and military service on the culture of hip hop. So, you know, there's a bunch of things we need to get into, and I do have notes that I'm going to be looking at from time to time, as usual. So first off, do we have any veterans in the house? Oh yeah, today is Veterans Day, which is one of the reasons for this specific topic. Do we have any veterans? Go ahead in the chat, let me know. So, let's see. And let's see how many people we have in here now. So we have the Society UK, Kevin Lando as well. The Society UK says, now this is something I'm going to enjoy learning too. I need to learn this right here. We have Mark Reed. I hope it's Mark. I think that's the way you pronounce it. So, something that really doesn't have anything to do with what we're talking about here is my hair is wet. You might see it dripping. And I figured out why my nose itches when I do this. So, usually I take a shower or wash my face or something to try to get the crust out so I don't be looking too terrible. And then I put lotion on. So either the lotion is causing it, or the lotion, I'm dry after doing this, washing my face or whatever. And then the lotion doesn't help. So my nose itches every time. So we have Ashley Potts in here. We have Cassette Coast from North Houston. What's up? All right, so first thing we could do before we get into the real meat of this, because I do find this subject interesting, we're going to talk about some of the people who have served. And we'll just talk about rappers and try to keep it in that vein. And so first, you have Fresh Kid Ice from 2 Live Crew, who served in the Air Force. Now, if you know anything about 2 Live Crew, they came about in the 80s. So this was early on. Now, we're also talking more specifically about the U.S. military too. So you have wartime and peacetime, and a lot of these people served during peacetime. So you had Vietnam happening in the late 60s and 70s, and then it kind of calmed down in the 80s. You had the little skirmishes and stuff, and a lot of people find that that's a good time to go ahead and join the military, and they all have their own reasons. But, you know, when you have those economic disadvantages and stuff, that entices a lot of people from certain circumstances and situations to go ahead and join the military for whatever reason, be it college tuition, whatever benefits you could get. And you can't leave out the fact that you get a paycheck and you get paid for being in the military. So that happens. So you have him. You also have Ice-T, who was in the Army. Now, some of these really do surprise me. And Ice-T, you know, coming from the West Coast. And Chris Shaw did mention Ice-T. Yeah. So I went out and I searched for all these people, you know, and it's really hard to try to come up with a list. And I hope that everyone else's sources is right, because, you know, I wasn't talking to these people firsthand. And, you know, I cross-referenced different articles and stuff to make sure that we come up with people who actually really were in the military, possibly. So, yeah, we had Ice-T. We also have MC Hammer, who would, I want to mention Run DMC in this vein, but I think MC Hammer was like the biggest hip-hop, the first really big hip-hop star, I could say. You know, Run DMC had their crossover thing, but then MC Hammer came, and yeah, he was in the Army. Yep. So we have, of course, Mystikal. We all know this. And one of the things about the No Limit Soldiers video, somebody mentioned that Mystikal always went the hardest because he was in the Army and he had, you know, more knowledge of that, whereas everyone else who was on those soldier songs just talked about it, maybe from secondhand experience or just stuff that they actually think about the military. So that's very interesting. And Canibus was in the army as well. Canibus, one of the hardest lyricists ever, who doesn't get brought up in people's top five, top tens, and who's pretty much what I would think just unthought of. Like, he's just kind of took a decline in the discussions, as well as like people like KRS-One and stuff too. And then you have No Malice from the Clips, who was in the army. Oh yeah, and MC Hammer was in the Navy. No Malice from the Clips was in the army, and you know you have Pusha T, who's still keeping the music thing going, and it's an interesting story behind him and his brother not doing music together anymore, because basically his brother is just done with it. Maybe he's tired of getting messed over and stuff. But yeah, that's crazy. Freddie Gibbs was in the army, and I'll say, he still had his time after that little back and forth they had. But yeah, Freddie Gibbs was in the army. Now, people who are closely connected to rap, I guess you could say, and who we consider hip-hop, Nate Dogg was a Marine, RIP Nate Dogg. And we have, of course, Shaggy, who a bunch of people mentioned, who was in the Marine Corps. And I don't know if you call what he did hip-hop, maybe? Could be. I guess you could call him a rapper when you kind of do that reggae singing stuff like that. So yeah, those are some people who were in the military. Now, some other people I have to mention who aren't considered rappers or hip-hop could be Jimi Hendrix, Marvin Gaye, Berry Gordy, John Coltrane, Sammy Davis Jr., Lou Rawls. These are big people in music who, of course, influenced a lot of stuff that happened in hip-hop and rap. And they're very significant to black music in general. Like, the stuff that they did was just amazing. And, you know, I just had to, I could not mention them. So those are the people. So who else could you think? I've seen a lot of people in the comments mentioning people who were in the military. And I think I got all of those that everyone named. Someone asked about Ice Cube, the Society UK. No, I don't believe Ice Cube. I think he went straight from school to doing NWA. So that's the case there. Now, before we get into the deep discussion, make sure you subscribe. So go ahead, click that subscribe button if you haven't already subscribed. So click the bell if you have. But I really appreciate everybody tuning in right now. And I'm going to be doing this often. So let me know if there's another time better to do these lives. All right. So we can talk about, before we get into the meat, some the last videos I've done before, since the last live. So we talked about Outkast and Spodeyoti Dopealicious. And after the video, I came to the conclusion that that horn is pretty much the greatest horn riff in hip-hop ever. And then I started to think about what sort of horn arrangements are really well known and are just really good, just in music in general, I guess. Or music that I listen to in general. And I could think of like Rocky. What else? Rocky, that one. And I'm sure it's a whole bunch more that you could think of. Maybe even Niggas in Trouble could be considered it. Even though that's just sort of like a synth thing. But I don't know. And I did listen to Ice Cube new song, Arrest the President. And those horns in there go so hard. Like, I love those horns, and you have them like hits, when you have hits and stabs and stuff in songs or on records. I really like this stuff, especially if you're doing it right. So, you know, I just wanted to mention that. So We had that Spodioti Dopalicious video, and we also had the video about Whoop, There It Is. Now, you know, these, this is like Miami bass music that we talked about here, and a lot of people mentioned the remix to the 95 South's version, and I do kind of really remember that one because of that part, "Excuse me, Sonny, do you know where I can find some booty?" I used to always repeat that line for years and years after that came out. So those are those Atlanta records, right? Even though it was Miami bass or booty bass or booty music that they called it. So we can transition from there or segue into talking about the time that these came out, 1993 Freaknik. Even in the video for Whoop, There It Is, 95 South, they mentioned Freaknik, and I believe it came out like right before Freaknik. When is Freaknik? Around March, April. So it came out just in time for this, and that music really touched a lot of people because people came from all over the United States and even possibly other places in the world for Freaknik. And shout out to Michael Reyes with the super chat donation. Thank you a lot. Thank everybody who loves to give and give support. But Michael Reyes says, "Hype, my dude, what's good, bro? I missed the last live about best down south group. I wanted to say Street Military." Yeah, I mentioned Street Military in that one, and they really go hard. And there are reasons that I think I mentioned in the video that I didn't include them amongst the top, but they definitely were hard hitters and very significant groups in the South. So a lot of people are talking about Freaknik and saying the Society UK says, "Freaknik, bro, you need to do a video about it." And Ashley Potts said Freaknik was the show enough-ish. Right. So people from all over came and they heard these songs, right? And there's things that shape culture. Hip hop is definitely culture. So we have to talk about these things the same way we talk about different cultures, right? So things happen. You could talk about Ireland and a potato famine or what possibly was not a famine, but you have economic situations, you have wars, you have all sorts of things that shape culture. So you have people migrating, which is one big way that culture moves, right? So you have let's take blues. I think I mentioned last live. You have blues or so, whatever, or jazz in the South, and you had those artists and people who were involved in that music migrating up north to places like New York, Chicago, and even like the Bay Area and Los Angeles. A lot of people came from Louisiana and Mississippi and, you know, dispersed into those areas. So in life, you know, we could take it back to around when hip hop, I guess, already had a foothold. You have people going to colleges, right? Now, you grow up, let's say you're in your same area. You're on the north side of Houston, south side of Houston, or wherever that may be. Up until you graduate high school, and then you're deciding whether or not we're going to go off into college. And you may leave, you may go hundreds of miles away, you may go thousands of miles away, but you're bringing with you, no matter any of those places you go, you're bringing your culture. You're bringing your food, you're bringing your music, you're bringing your style of dress, your hairstyles, and all of these things. Now, one thing that was happening back in the 80s is you had a veteran by the name of Bill Cosby who had a TV show that a whole bunch of people watched, and he would wear these sweaters and he would talk about historically black colleges and universities. And I think that really did play a big part in people going out to these universities and historically black colleges, right? So now, because the thing is a little different when you, let's say, concentrating a lot of black people in one place, right? Because when you have your historically black colleges and universities, they're kind of going to be sprinkled throughout. So let's say in Illinois, I'm not sure of this. Let's say you just had two there, right? But, you know, the white universities that you had the opportunity to go to at that time after the civil rights movement was, you know, let's say 50 in a state like Illinois. Maybe we can say 20, 25, significantly more. So you're going to have less black colleges, but you're going to have all these people who were invested or who were consumers of this black art form, as we can call it. So you have people coming from Chicago, Cleveland, Philadelphia, Seattle, all these places. And they're all coming together at these universities because there was this big push at the time to get this, you know, to get your education as black people. You have the opportunity out there. So this may have been people who were children of the people from Vietnam and even possibly the grandchildren of the ones from World War II, you know, after the GI Bill. So we tie this into the military by saying that back in those days, you probably didn't have a lot of economic opportunities if you were black. And one of the ways you could help your family out and try to get some economic advantage, I guess, is to join the military and then possibly go to college and stuff. So you could have been two generations away by the time you get to the late 80s and 90s because of people going to colleges. Now, when you go to college, that's one of those times where you're meeting people from different places. So you have your boy Ray, you have your girl Ashley, and they're bringing their possibly albums, their cassettes, and their CDs, depending on the time that they at those colleges, and you're bringing yours. And you are exchanging these things. So this is the sort of thing that happens in colleges, you know, and the same can apply to the military as well. So let's say, oh, I wanted to share. I was wondering why I was talking about this. One of my notes, I went off to college for a little while. And there were people from, it was LSU. I'll just tell you that it was a lot of people from New Orleans there who I hung with a lot because that was, I guess, the biggest city in Louisiana. A lot of people are going to be from there. You had some people from Baton Rouge. You had people from places like Memphis, all over, you know, because this is one of those bigger universities, I guess. And that's when I first, like, really listened to people like Yo Gotti and Boosie, like, way back. And it was because of the people from those places, or even going to a place like Baton Rouge and hearing about their music scene, you know, hearing their language, looking at some of the way the people were dancing from New Orleans at the time. And, you know, we were exchanging that sort of thing. So I brought over my stuff too, where I say, hey, you could listen to some, Zero at the time. These people hadn't heard of Zero. And, you know, listening to people from those different places and the stuff outside of where they're from that they listen to. So there was this heavy Nas and Jay-Z thing from the people of New Orleans at the time in the late 90s and early 2000s. So yeah, you had that going on. So besides college, you had what we're talking about here, the military itself. Now, this is another one of those situations. You in your economic situation or whatever, maybe you just love your country and you want to go fight. You want to have some purpose or whatever. Whatever the reason may be, you leave where you're from and you're inevitably going to be stationed somewhere else. Even if temporarily, you may move around to all these different places. And in the military, you're bringing all of that culture with you, just as you would bring all that culture to you when you go to college. And then you have your roommates and stuff that you're going to exchange with. So a lot of people in the comments of videos, like the one about UNLV's diss, a lot of those Southern records, all that Memphis stuff, one of the things that people say who aren't from the South, when I talk about down South stuff, they say, hey, I was in the military and the cats from Houston or the cats from Texas or the cats from Louisiana were jamming this, and that's why I heard about these songs and I added it to my collection, basically. We'll get back into this, but we're going to go to the comments real fast and see what you're talking about there, and we'll get more into it. Ashley Potts says, yeah, bro, if you joined the military back then, you were able to get funding, good credit opportunities, able to purchase a home, go to school, etc. I think they got rid of it. I don't know about that part about it getting rid of.
You got benefits.
Yeah. Let's see. The Society UK asks, GI Bill question mark. So GI Bill is basically this legislation or whatever that was wrote where, you know, military people who join the military get out and stuff, get all sorts of government benefits and stuff like that. So when I talk about that, and I'm talking about maybe the late 40s, 50s, I'm talking about a time where there was still segregation in the South, and you could go to the military and you would be able to, you know, get some sort of education after that, you know, and be able to pay for some college and stuff because of those sorts of benefits. Society UK asked, who was the first one to drop a military rap hype? I don't know. Maybe you could ask people in the comments and they'll let you know who was the first to have a military rap. Yeah. So back to this stuff about the military. A lot of people talk about that. You know, first time I heard of this song, first time I heard of this artist, and you're bringing all that with you. One thing I think about human nature is to try, and you know, let's say humans just want to advance the species, right, by procreating. Another thing, though, as humans, we want to advance our culture as well. You know, you want people to be excited about what you're excited about and partake in that stuff. So you're bringing along the foods that you eat. You're talking about, and, you know, you're trying to share this stuff with people. You're hearing people say things that you've never heard before. You're hearing music that you haven't heard before. And I don't know how different that is now. I'm sure there are still local artists, but I'm not sure if the youngsters now have that attachment to their regions that was going on earlier, right? So you had something that I mentioned all the time. You have people speaking their own languages from these different regions or different cities or different states. You have people who have their own sounds within hip hop. You have certain styles of rapping within hip hop as well. So you had the country in that sense was totally different. You know, it wasn't all pretty much the same. Everything was different and you were hearing this different stuff. So like, a lot of people may not know, I was in the military myself, and like, I had a roommate who listened to country music, right? I didn't grow up listening to country music, and I definitely wasn't constantly seeking out country artists. But I would listen to some songs he would listen to by, like, Kenny Chesney, Alan Jackson, and stuff like that. So it opened up some of my references, right, that I could even incorporate into my production and my writing, right? I had some cats from Chicago or some cats from New York and Philadelphia, and maybe I'll hear about Black Ice and stuff like that. And then, of course, I'm sharing the stuff that I'm listening to with them. And when I was in, a lot of my time, I was in California. And this was around the time that the hyphen movement got really big, too. So I could say I sort of experienced that firsthand. You had reggaeton that was getting really big. And, you know, the big Hispanic population in California and in the military was very different than that in Louisiana. So I was experiencing all this stuff by signing a piece of paper and getting sent off to these different places. So, you know, it was really weird. So Matt Troop says, anyone else feed wigging out? I don't know. Y'all let me know if the feed is bad. It's looking good on this end. I have a couple running just to make sure. Just to make sure. So, yeah. So, and another thing, like, when I was in Louisiana, you had, y'all know I'm a big fan of Houston, New Orleans, and that sort of thing. You had that whole New Orleans coming up with Master P and Cash Money. So in Louisiana, if I'm watching this on TV, I'm like, wow, the rest of the country or even the rest of the world get to see what's going on. So let's say we have trouble with the audio. Let me check my settings. A little noise here and there. All right, maybe because I am hitting the cord. I don't know. I'm going to try to keep this going. Let me know if you have any more problems. So, as I was saying, you see these artists come up on TV. So, I was in California in the club. And one day I heard Cupid Shuffle, right? So immediately it come on and I know the voice, and I'll get to that later. Have a cell phone too close. I don't know. Is that what it sounds like? Let me know. Let me know how the sound is. So Cupid Shuffle came on. And I was like, wait, I know Cupid. And then he's talking about Zydeco, you know what I'm saying? Which is a cultural thing. So, just as a backstory, I know Cupid because he had some songs out around the time I was in Louisiana rapping and everything. And, you know, we had probably some shows together and stuff. And we always crossed paths. But, you know, being in California because of the military... Mic popping. I'm going to turn it off and turn it back on so it might click really loud. All right. Can anybody hear me? Maybe I'm just too close because I'm talking really loud. Oh, some people say they don't hear a popping sound. That's cool. So anyway, Cupid was, you know, we crossed paths a bunch of times. And because of the military, I was in California and I got to see from a different place how people were reacting to this Cupid song. It just like came on out of the blue. And I was like, wow, that's Cupid. And I hope I got that right that I was in California. But I do kind of remember being in California in a club and the Cupid Shuffle came on. And I was like, wow, that's so crazy. And yes, I was in the Marine Corps, if you don't know. You probably don't know. I was in the Marine Corps. And funny story, you know, people mentioned Shaggy being a veteran. My recruiter knew I was rapping or whatever. And one of his things to try to sell me was Shaggy was in the Marine. Like, that doesn't matter to me because I already planned on joining, you know. But he was just trying to make it seem like so much better by trying to have me relate more to that. It's kind of crazy. So, there we have it. Make sure you subscribe. We're going to get into the comments. I'm going to try to go back and look at some comments that I missed. And then every once in a while, if I forgot something, I'll go ahead and explain that as well. So, Johnny Rojas, what's up again? I don't know if you were in the last broadcast, Johnny, last Sunday. But he says, when Mystikal came to No Limit, you can tell he had a major influence with his military background. They would wear their army fatigues on stage. Whoa, excuse me. Master P brought out the army tank in music videos. Yeah, I think that, you know, that was a part of just their branding, right? And I had a joke prepared that I didn't put out. I was going to mention Master P being a colonel, but that opportunity has passed. But no, I just think that was their branding. But like when he brought that tank out, I was like, oh my, this dude is amazing. H-Town Lifer says, I'm in here finally. What's up, H-Town Lifer? Huh, Cassette Coast says, what's drama in the military? I don't know, but he had that jamming song though. Matt Truth says, I can hear. So I guess I kind of fixed that audio issue. The Society UK says, Johnny, I didn't know at the time what style he brought, but I noticed all the army fatigues more frequent after he joined. Yeah, it was an interesting time. Yes, the Society UK drama is the one who did that left, 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 right, left jam. Yeah, so also while I was in, when I was in the military, you had, in Iraq, I'll say, I went to Iraq, you had people from like Alabama and Atlanta and stuff who were also from the South. And, you know, you could hear about the artists who they listened to, like The Last Mr. Big or whatever, but you, the songs that you enjoy, you know, even if you already know of these artists, aren't the same as the people from those areas that they're listening to. So one of the songs from like Mr. Biggs that they would listen to was Trafficking and stuff like that. And this one guy, he gave me this CD that I'm sure I still have somewhere. This guy was from Alabama, but somebody from somewhere else in the country who he knew from Mississippi gave him a CD from this guy, President Bill. I forgot the guy's name. Oh my. But he was from Vicksburg. If you're from Vicksburg or around or know something about that, it was this guy, President Bell or something, who had this jamming CD around 2003, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. I don't know. But I still go back and listen to this guy all the time because of those military connections. And of course, I shared my music with people so I could get a idea of what other people's taste was. Like, I could have people from my corner of Louisiana like my music, but if I get it, somebody from Southern California, somebody from Tacoma, somebody from Philadelphia, all giving me their takes on what I'm making, you know, then that's pretty amazing. Because you didn't have internet the way that you had it right now, so you couldn't get that feedback from people from different places as well. So I'm sure that the military could help a lot of people in the art that they're making and as well. And some people say I don't have an accent, and maybe that plays a part in it too. You know, spending a lot of time away from Louisiana and intermingling with people of different accents and trying to express myself as I do now and still be understood at the same time. It's a tough thing to balance. So one of the things I wanted to mention is my Discord server. We have a lot of chat going on in there all the time. And like the Society UK is up in there. Gutter Boy, who's not here at this time, be up in there. Some guy, Anti-Race. I don't know which one. You have a different name in here. But I dropped the link for my Discord server and you can all join that. There's even voice chat in there too. So, and the other day I hopped on voice chat. So, you know, we can talk there sometimes, you know, and it kind of had me slacking on my work because it's, I can't talk, listen and edit sound and stuff at the same time. But I jump in there from time to time. It's text chat and voice chat. Yeah. So Mark Reed says, Master P had everyone thinking the whole No Limit was veterans. Oh, yeah. So one thing we did when I was doing music, we showed up for this big show in Houston, and we had on camouflage. We had another member who was in the Army, my partner Lil Joe, RIP. He was in the army, and there's pictures out there with us in all of his military gear, but we all had on camouflage and stuff, and people were coming up to us. Out of all the groups there, you had names way bigger than who we were coming up to us, asking us where we were from, what we do. And a lot of people were like, we know you're from Louisiana because of the camouflage. So Master P and what they did had a big influence on even the way people see rappers and people from Louisiana. And then, of course, you had like Soulja Slim and all them back in those days. So Andre had left a comment. Andre Wallace, he said, "Oh, you live," with a fire emoji. What's up, Andre? Appreciate you being a patron. I really appreciate it. Mark Reed asked, "Where are you from?" "I'm from Southwest Louisiana." Rodney Bell says, "Music was everything in that military, especially on them 6-month cruises." That's hilarious. So, the thing about the music is, in the beginning, I would say I was really bored, right? And I built up a good bit of my CD collection while I was in the military. You know, ain't got nothing to do, sit around, drink, and listen to music. And, you know, I would just go buy CDs and listen to them over and over and over. And, you know, I'm playing music, people come over, "Hey, what you listening to?" You know, and a lot of it was Zero and stuff. And I'll share one Zero story a different time. I don't know when, but I have a good Zero story. Telvis Jacquet says, "I was in basic training in Fort Benning, Georgia back in 93. They put on MC Shy-D, and he had been out for years, never heard of him. And I put them on South Park Coalition." Yeah, like, we love to share culture and stuff, no matter what. And hip-hop is culture, and that's one of those things. Let's say I'm from Louisiana. I'm a screwhead, and I go to Houston. What am I going to do in Houston in the mid-late 90s? Coming from basically anywhere other than Houston or Southside Houston, Texas. You're going to bring back some of those goods. You're going to go to the screw shop and get screws, right? If you go to Miami, you're going to go there. You're going to intentionally put on some pirate radio. You're going to go and try to find out what the people there listen to, what they eat. You're going to go to those mom and pop record shops, and you're going to try to find an album or something. I hope that's what you've done in those days. Like, first thing you do when you get Napster, you're going to go download some stuff that you never heard before. So, yeah. Captain Bread said, "Gangsta Pat did a show at Fort Hood in 98. Huh. Yeah. This week. Matt Truth said, "How come you haven't posted on you and your girl's other channel lately?" Oh, it's coming. We're having, it's like we're putting in a lot of thought, and it's just going to be really technical, but I just put it that way. We're developing something that's really good, or working on something that's more really, yeah, that's more than just putting on the camera and recording it. So if you don't know what he's talking about, I have another channel with Cherie, who helps me out a lot, even with this channel. It's called Heit and Cherie, and you can always go and subscribe to that channel. And I really appreciate everybody who has already gone and subscribed to that channel. But thank you a lot for even noticing that we didn't upload there. And it's coming real soon. Oh, yeah. Oh, my. How could I forget? Telvis Jacquet says, "E Vicious was also in the military." Yeah, if you go back and you watch my X-Mob videos, Bundy G mentions that, you know, they, you know how Vicious was in the military and stuff, and basically that's how a rap group was formed by the military, and we could get into all the boot camp cliques and stuff like that. But yeah, that's one thing. Andre Wallace asks, Heit, do you have any new projects coming up far as music? I'm thinking about this video about music. So I'm always working on projects, and this video will explain it a little more, but I am planning on releasing some Heit the Great music. Right now, I have one song out that you could find on Spotify and all that. The name is just Heit. It's not Heit the Great. And the song is I'm That Boy. It's an old song, and I've had it in one of my older videos, but I do have some music coming eventually. Just be on the lookout.
And you'll let
them
know.
And of course, I will let you know in on this channel. Ronnie Bell says, I'm from Mo City, bro. That's what's up. I put boys on Zero versus the World as soon as they threw Jay-Z in my face. Oh, yeah, this was always, like, people would be mentioning. And, like, let's say I'm in college or whatever. And I know I told you, I wrote my final on a Zero album. Like, this is how dedicated to this I was. I'm like, I don't care who you are. You could be this doctor, professor guy. You're going to hear about Riding Dirty. You're going to hear about Zero. You're going to hear about this stuff. Because every time you give me an assignment where I can write about anything I want, I won't. This is the stuff that I'm going to talk about. So, yeah, spreading that culture. So, I think I'm responsible for hip-hop being as popular today as it is. It's a joke. Soul of the South says, Yo, Heit, what part of Southwest Louisiana you're from? I'm from Port Arthur. Lake Charles, Gosport, baby. Ha! Juan Marley says, do a vid on Big Mike, fam. Yeah, it's coming. They're all coming. So, the Society UK says, I'll collab with you, Heit. We'll see what happens. Captain Breed. Trey D has an album called The General's List. What's that about, The General's List? Mark Reed says, where can I find your music at? Oh, and the Society UK says, he says Spotify. If everybody keep asking me for this, I'm just going to go ahead and drop a whole bunch of stuff. And then that'll just be the end of it until next time. But I couldn't, at any point, I can drop some music. So just go ahead and drop that fire emoji if you want me. If you want me to drop some music. And I could do like, hey, 10 to 14 songs. I would probably do more like 13 or 14 songs because I just have them. You haven't heard it. And I could do it at any time. So drop that fire emoji if you want me to drop an album before Christmas. Now, all of this won't be new stuff. But you can hear some of the stuff I made. And I think it's really amazing. yeah. DMD4444 says, Cherie over there whispering. I'm like, yeah, why is she whispering? I know they can hear you. The mic is like right here. And she's right there. So you can't hear her. Andre Wallace says, drop it.
Everybody
said drop it. Mark Reed said, drop it. Oh, yeah. Hey, did you check out that Romero Bond and Clicka One featuring SPM? No, but I have a good... Now that you mention SPM, you know I mentioned in the military, like, the Hispanic or Latino representation is really, really high. And I was in Southern California where the Mexican population is really high. And you know that SPM has a lot of Latino fans, right? And I already knew about SPM, all of this stuff, but my Mexican partners and even a lot of the Puerto Rican ones, they really, really, really love SPM. Like, you could always listen to, well, they were always listening to SPM, so I was listening to all of their songs with them. You know, we're riding around you know, the passengers, the DJ or whatever, or vice versa. So much South Park Mexican. And like, who is this? Who are those other cats? Southwest Riders or something? Let me know. It was like two guys and they always had singing on their hooks. They were Hispanic cats. But yeah, South Park Mexican. I got to know him intimately. Not in the way you're probably thinking, because of being in the military. Rodney Bell says, come to think of Louisiana was deep in that Navy. Boys had me sounding like I was from the boot for at least 6 months. Always effed with Louisiana rappers as they play on words. Yeah, like it was from, you know, all over the place. You had these, of course, you always had the California. It was still like an East Coast, West Coast thing after, you know, Tupac and Biggie died, in terms of like who had rougher lives and stuff like that, who had the better rappers. But it was more like a friendly thing, you know, people fighting over, oh, people from New York can't even drive, and then the people from New York saying we don't need to drive anywhere. Like, when you have people who are attached to their homes and your home being part of your culture, you're going to have those little friendly competitions and people always trying to get you to at least acknowledge some of the brilliance and, you know, some of the greatness that comes from where they're from. Shafi Davis says, when I was in the Navy, I out them? Huh? I don't understand. I got them Atlanta boys on Boosie. They was getting on my nerves with that Pastor Troy stuff. Oh, yeah. Like, that was Pastor Troy, when he came out, you know, that was pretty cool, though. Captain Bread said, Chamillionaire did that army call, the military. Maybe it was Chamillionaire, you know. I don't know. I don't know what you're saying by that. I don't remember the album called the Army. So, I don't know. Let's go ahead. Yeah, let's see. Telvis, I don't know how to pronounce your name. Jaquette, I'll just keep saying. Hey, people might not believe it, but MC Hammer and Ice-T served in the military. Yes. Hopefully, this video is going to be on replay on the channel after it's over. But I did mention it early on. I went through people like Canibus, Ice-T, MC Hammer, Fresh Kid Ice from 2 Live Crew, Freddie Gibbs, Nate Dogg, Shaggy, even mentioned people like Jimi Hendrix, Sammy Davis Jr., Berry Gordy, Marvin Gaye, all that. So, yeah, we talked about all that stuff. Yep. So, we're sitting at 50 minutes now, almost. And I try to keep these short, but we'll keep going as long as you have stuff to say. If you would, please consider supporting me on Patreon. One of the things I do on there is every once in a while, you get early access to some of my videos. So before they drop, I go ahead and I put them out for the patrons, depending on your level of patronage, I guess you could call it, depending on your level. So this week, I'm going to have one come out early for all my patrons who meet that threshold. But if you could just become a $1 patron, that would be great. That's $1 a month. Like, to a lot of people, you know, it's nothing. But to me, it's a whole lot. It lets me know that, you know, I do have supporters here and people who want to keep this thing going, where I continue to put out, I guess what you could call, informative videos where people learn stuff. And I push this culture and share some of these things that we live through for the younger people, and push this stuff forward where we can get out some of the things that were happening in the 80s, 90s, early 2000s, and whenever So there's a link in the chat for my Patreon. And if you can do that, just go ahead. It's not required. I will still put out videos, but you get some extra things if you go ahead and become a patron. Let me get a drink of water. My lips are dry. Woo! We're going so great. Is everybody having a good time out there? Oh, I need to sneeze. 1 second. Yeah. I didn't get to the mute button fast enough. All right. So Matt Truth said if he wasn't broke, he would be with me on Patreon. That's cool. You know, oh, Mark Reed, thank you for the super chat. He donated $1. Thank you a lot. I really appreciate that. Cassette Coast, Mind of Mystikal. And now, and you know, since we're on this military thing, I want you to know that the military will be brought up in one of these videos that's coming up this week. You know, maybe just in passing, but I think about this stuff when we talk about this. You know, we're like, hey, today I happen to be talking about the military on Veterans Day and some videos I'm working on. Military service is brought up. Yeah. So, yeah, that's all we have today. The military plays a big part in hip hop because people go to different places, you experience different things, you incorporate that into what you're doing, right? So let's say you have filmmakers, cooks, artists, I guess you call them painters, whoever, different types of artists, people who do sculptures, rappers, producers. You experience different cultures around the world, different cultures within the United States. And then on the consumer side, you have people spreading their culture or their subculture of hip hop, spreading it with other people. Like, that's really, really huge. And I don't think that it's ever really brought up. I don't think it was ever really brought up, to be honest, publicly in this way. Thanks, Rodney Bell, for the super chat. And a lot more could be done and said. And when I brought this up, I already thought about doing more on the topic, more in depth, more details. We'll see what that turns into. But yeah. Mark Reed said, I support Louisiana. I really like what you're doing. Thank you. Andre Wallace says, yeah, Heit, I appreciate the channel. I think you should do a documentary on yourself. Wow. On myself. That may eventually come. I wouldn't want to be the one to do it, right? I would have to, yeah, Cherie would have to do it. I think I told her enough of my story where she knows the story. She probably knows who to go and talk to and stuff like that. And maybe I'll do some editing.
I know it better than you.
Cherie says she knows my story better than me. Thank you, Mark Beast, for that super chat. Wow, I really appreciate all this. Thank you, Mark Beast. He said he reps the boot, too. Mark Beast, did you check out my X-Mob videos that I have on this channel? Let me know. If you haven't, when this is done, go and check those out. You'll get a kick out of those if you didn't see them. Captain Brett says, 3-6 did a support the troops track. Okay, I must say this, since you mentioned that. I know this guy who I served in the military with, and he did a Support the Troops track, and he put a spin on it, and I have a copy of it somewhere, probably the only copy in the world, because of course he doesn't have the copy, but I have to find it on some hard drive, some CD somewhere. It was a really good track, and it was just, you know, people talk about PTSD, all that stuff, and, you know, he really talked about it, and, you know, I have it somewhere. I don't know. I haven't been able to find it when I look at it, but I haven't really dedicated a lot of time. But he did a really good track that I always think about when I think about military service and the troops. Cassette Coast says, do a vid on Tila and the Suave Rap-A-Lot situations. There is one on the channel already about Show Nuff. So, yeah. The Society UK says, Heit, I've watched all your videos, bro. Every single one of them? Did you watch the videos before I took them down? I have videos. I had possibly 150 videos, but if you look now, you won't see 150. And maybe slowly I'll roll those back out. Since you're asking me about the music that I've done, I had some of that old stuff. But a lot of my stuff you could probably just find if you Googled it, because some of that stuff is out there. And you better do it now, because I may end up taking that stuff down too. But yeah, I have some stuff out there. I also have a channel called Hot Water ENT. So you may see some old footage of me on there. And don't be too hard on me on it, because it's some old stuff. But yeah, I have some stuff on there. Andre Wallace says, I'm going to try to get my girl into your other channel. Yeah, that's cool. And you also will like the channel once you see what's coming up. So we have some stuff lined up for the other channel, Heit and Cherie. Mark Beast. I was in the game back in the 90s. I'm familiar with everything you post, and I still rap today. I know a lot of those cats personally. That's what's up. That is what's up. Like, people will be surprised about the people who, you know, I have a small channel here. People would be surprised that the people who I talk about in those videos and stuff have seen those videos. Like, I come across it all the time where they either reposted or something, or they're in the comments or something. So they're seeing this stuff, and it's up to you, as supporters, if you want to share wherever you can, so we can get some other people up on this stuff that we talk about, you know, sharing our culture and what we grew up on. Matt Truth says, you, me, and my wife.
Yeah.
Oh, me and my wife. Watch the other channel. You are both awesome. Thank you, Matt Truth. The Society UK. I love a video on Tila. World Ain't Enough. That was an absolute banging album. Yeah, we'll see. There's so much stuff coming up. So what I'm doing right now with the videos, I am trying to not get set into like a specific formula, because that gets boring, right? So you will end up seeing the same video over and over. So I'm trying to, well, I'm making sure that I take different approaches to this stuff to keep it interesting and to be able to bring out new interesting information. Not every time, but every time, if you understand what I'm saying. Cassette Coast says, will you ever look to interview artists? Seems like you have good convos with people. You know, I try, you know, being the size that I am, some people just don't respond, of course. And, you know, eventually we'll see. And hopefully they didn't pass up the opportunity. But we'll see. Maybe it takes 100,000 subscribers. Maybe it takes every video to have 100,000 views. I don't know. Maybe it takes more Instagram followers or Twitter followers, which is up here somewhere. You know, I don't know. But, you know, maybe I have to formulate better emails. Whatever. We'll see, though. I'm trying to get into that. I may have something that surprises you, that someone I was able to get into contact with. And we'll see how that turns out. Rodney Bell says, have you heard of a group out of Most City called Faculty? I don't know. So the thing about this is, you get lots of groups with similar names and stuff and artists. I think I've heard of a group or something called the faculty? I don't know if this is the same group. Is this a new group or an old group? Mark Reed says, basically do a video on a G to a key. I remember listening to their tape way back in the day. Matt Truth says, I like this channel because this is different. Nothing like everyone else is doing. So you guys have to help me get it bigger, because once the big people come and they see what we're doing here, they're going to try to do it. And if we already at a big enough level, you know, then we'll be known for this. Otherwise, I'll just be forgotten when everyone else starts to do this. So just remember, though. But that's one of the reasons why I do this, too. So you have, you know, all these conversations about hip hop and everything, but the ones who get mentioned aren't the people who we know about and we know their stories. You know, like when they talk about basically who started doing live instrumentation and hip hop and with samples and stuff, you know, or the different stuff that was going on, like who played a part in making hip hop as big as it is, or the way that it is now, or who was even really lyrical or had really good hip hop beats, and was the South really hip hop or even knew their history. And of course, it's obvious, you know, in the videos that I make, that these producers and everybody and the artists knew about the hip hop before them. I just wish the young people now took more interest in that, because they have access to all that old stuff, you know, that people even back in the, you know, mid-90s didn't have, you know, to go out and research, I guess, you know, the hip-hop history before them. But most of it, I guess, a good overview is out there for the youngsters today. DMD4444 asks, what high school did you go to? Are you from Lake Charles? I'll just let you know, I'm from Gosport, so that should let you know what high school I went to. I was the cat at school with the fro and a bag full of CDs. That was me back in high school. I was the cat with the CDs. Captain Bread says, there was a rapper named Camouflage. Yeah, a lot of people. The thing about the military and hip-hop, you know, if you listen to rappers and stuff, they like to attach themselves to like the mob and mafia and sort of like organized crime. And it's something about that organization, you know, that make people feel like bosses. Like the military stands for like strength and power. You know what I'm saying? So like if you come out and you're like, hey, I'm a soldier, or I'm the colonel of this battalion or platoon or whatever, you know, it's like kind of saying like, I'm powerful, I have strategy, and, you know, I'm basically the shit, in short. Johnny Rojas, stay ahead of the game with your video content. I learn so much on every video you drop. Thanks a lot, Johnny Rojas. Rodney Bell, old group that had 4 members. They were associated with the Killer Klan, Bam, Street Military, Klondike Cat. So were they South Park Coalition? That's what it sounds like you're saying here. I don't know. I kind of remember. I have to go back and look. So a lot of these times, you mention songs, artists, and groups, and then I go back and I'm like, oh yeah, man, I was listening to them all the time. But it's really hard to have these people at the front of your minds all the time. Some people are better than others. Some people, you can name somebody, you can name a year, and they'll tell you all about it. Like, I know this one guy. I could just be like, name a song, and he'll be like, oh yeah, that was 1992 around the springtime. And then I look it up, and he was generally right if it was like movies or songs and stuff. So some people have that great ability. I'm not one of them. I just generally remember things, I guess you could say. Why are you laughing? Sheree is over here laughing. Cassette Coast. Is there a specific artist or song that you feel marked the decline of quality artistry in mainstream hip-hop? All right, let me see if I get this right, because I don't know if I remember the artist. Maybe it's two songs. Was it Mims, This Is Why I'm Hot? Did Mims make This Is Why I'm Hot? And was he from New York? If that's the case, This Is Why I'm Hot. That was like, all right, this whole time I've been talking about us wanting to push our culture, right? I want you to like the music I like. I want you to like the type of sound I like. I want you to like the type of hooks I like. And then we had an artist who come out. So Society UK says he did, and he's from New York. We had this guy from New York says, hey, I'm gonna make music just like people from the South. That's where I didn't know at the time. That's the point I go to where I say, all right, this is going to be a great decline, because you have to realize people wanted that difference. People wanted to be separate. So now you get somebody from New York and they're accepted for doing something like that, you know, and didn't have great success from it because, you know, the South was ruling. I used to always have this line, you know, certain rappers have lines in their songs that they say. I used to always say, they said the South would rise again, but they didn't know that it would be in rap music. And that was even before the South got really big. So the people from New York was really sticking to their style. And, you know, this guy came up, had a song, sounds like it's from the South. Now, if you're young right now, you probably don't understand this, to say that, you know, somebody sounds like they were from the South. But even in those mid-noughts, I guess, is it called noughts? In the mid-noughts, mid-2000s, you could hear a distinct difference in New York rap and Southern rap. And this guy from New York said, hey, I'm making this song. I'm going to try to sound like these other people out here who's getting all of the money, getting all of the popularity. And he kind of got accepted somewhat in New York. Then you had the other people come out trying to do that same thing. And then, you know, next thing you know, everything is the South. And now what I was thinking about the other day, everything is trap. So it used to be like you have Southern rap or you have mumble rap and this other rap. Now, when you talk about modern hip hop or rap, some people don't like to call it hip hop, but when you talk about modern rap, you're talking about trap. And that's just the way it is. And I guess that makes it easier and harder, right? So if you're making something that sounds different, you're probably not going to really be accepted widespread. And if you're making something that sounds like everyone else, you may be accepted more, but then everybody else is doing the exact same thing. So, you know, who is the better Future or Migos imitator? You know what I'm saying? Like, it's just so different. So it was about that time when that Mims came out where I was just like, oh my God, I don't know what's going to happen here. Society UK says Mims track Kanye 40 the Dre made the beat. I don't understand. Do you? Why did you I retype your comment to Society UK. Johnny Rojas, thank you a lot for your super chat. He did a $2 donation. Thank you a lot. Thank you everybody for tuning in. You know, every time I press that button, or Cherie presses that button to stream, we never know if people are going to show up. Or even when I drop videos, I don't know if people are going to watch these things. But I really like to thank you for doing that. Cassette Co said, whistle while you twerk, mark the decline for me. Oh, why? I don't know. Like, I don't know why you would think that. You have to explain that further. Why did Whistle While You Twerk mark the decline, Cassette Coast? So, this is another thing. Maybe your touching point with Yin Yang Twins was different. So, somebody mentioned in a previous live, or maybe some other comment, that Yin Yang Twins was one of the hardest groups. Maybe that was the last live. Yin Yang Twins was one of the hardest groups out of the South. Were they spitting anything different before this Whistle While You Twerk? Because I didn't know about the Yin Yang Twins before that era where they started dropping those songs. I guess that was the late 90s, early 2000s. So I don't know. The Society Use Case says, I thought, so I heard of them before. Can't remember where. Huh. Oh, he's talking to Rodney Bell, who says, I can't see it. Went away. So, I'm reading your comments, though. Cassette Coast replied and said, Whistle While You Twerk dropped the same time frame as Nas Hate Me Now. I was in the vibe, and that damn whistling killed me. I think that was very creative. You know, you had the Whistle While You Work song, and then that beat just dropped, and that beat was hard. You know what I'm saying? And then how the beat drops out on the hook. Like, when I look at these things, sometimes I focus heavily on the content, and other times I look at it as a whole production or whatever. But, you know, I thought at the time that came out, it was hard. But now when I listen to it, I could barely stand it. I'd be like, what the? Dun, 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 dun. Oh, man. It gets on my nerves, too. Miss Blackbuster D says, hello, Heit. Glad to catch you live. Thank you, Miss Blackbuster D. I'm glad you could catch it, too. So, do y'all watch football or anything? If you do, I want to say thank you a lot for not watching whatever game is on right now. Instead, watch me. So we could talk about some of this great hip-hop stuff. The Society UK says, Yin Yang Twins was the new party rap, just like 69 Boys, 2 Live Crew, etc. I enjoyed them, but got repetitive. Yeah. So, what? Cassette Coast basically mentioned the line, go ahead and start and make that. Yeah. Hey. But see, the thing is, if you go back to 2 Live Crew, I think I have a hair over here. 2 Live Crew was saying some outrageous things. Or like, let's say Bust Down. He fought it in her mouth and made her cheeks inflate. Come on, dude. Like, this stuff happens in hip hop. You go back, listen to Gangsta Nip and people who like Eminem. People say outrageous things on rap songs, and just depending, like, the thing is, you had, if you didn't like that, you had the Nas to go to listen to. You know what I'm saying? Like, you could go listen to Nas all the time, listen to Nas on the way to the club, but when you get in the club, you want that Yin Yang Twins to come on. This is funny. We got into a Whistle While You Twerk session. Ivory Harris II says, Lake Charles in the building. Yes, sir. Northside, what's up? North the I-10? Where you from, Ivory? For everybody who don't know, yes, I'm from Lake Charles, Louisiana. Mark Reed says, Shreveport, LA, invented Ratchet. Yes. Maybe, I don't know, maybe next live or maybe some video, I could talk about everything that Louisiana has contributed to the world in that sense. Like, a lot of stuff come from Louisiana that's became mainstream. Miss Blackbuster D says, the end of the Whistle While You Twerk was the highlight of the song. Oh, man. Oh, see, Rodney Bell is laughing at Bust Down. Yeah. Oh, Ivory Harris is from The Terrace. So one thing about The Terrace is the streets in The Terrace are named after people in the military. I don't know if they're Confederates or not, but they have all those generals and people's names like that. Little spot in neighborhood in Lake Charles called The Terrace. See? So that's one thing I'll give myself credit for. So I may not be able to remember everything intimately, but like these, I guess you could call it sort of word association things. When people tell me stuff like this, or I hear about the terrorists and we still talking about the military, stuff like that, just those dots connecting, I guess you could say, just pops up in my mind. Like, oh, the terrorists, we're on this subject of the military, and the streets there are after military folks, presumptively. I hope I'm right. I don't know who those people are. The Society UK, that whole Lil Jon early era was crunk. Yeah. So, you know, since this is really, you know, we did it in a context about the military, this is also, you know, about how hip-hop evolved, right? So when we talk about Miami bass going to Atlanta and all this, or crunk formulating and possibly Memphis and Atlanta, or that it could possibly be also that influence from, you know, Miami and Memphis and Atlanta all coming together. Like, all these genres and everything all stem from somewhere, especially since, you know, coming up from New York or down from New York, right? So it's all about just that. It's all about, like, let's say I did a video about UGK, Feds in Town, and Diamonds and Wood. Like, how did all these people get together? Well, I can't go through on every single video. How did the people get together? How did, you know, the families get to Port Arthur, right? How did these people end up at the same schools? How did Pimp C end up playing in Oregon, right? How did they find these samples, right? Where did the people who made these samples come from? Like, why would a person from Port Arthur or Texas even listen to these older songs, you know, that helped to become what you call country rap tunes, that I call Southern rap, that we call Houston rap, even though they're from Port Arthur, right? How did UGK become Houston rappers? You know what I'm saying? Like, this is all we're talking about. Miss Black Busta D, 2 Live was very popular in the D. We like fast house music. So by the D, do you mean Dallas or Detroit? Let me know. If it's Dallas, then I think of who someone mentioned in the last live, Nemesis and stuff. So I guess that would be like real sped up hip hop. Why does it have to be Detroit?
Because you said house music.
Oh, house. Oh, yeah. So Detroit, the place that got us techno, right? Techno was invented in Detroit, right? So that sort of thing, like, in the Midwest, you're going to have those influences in hip-hop, like the sound of Detroit, Chicago, maybe even Go-Go in Washington. Because those places are closer, you're going to have some variation of that house music or electronic sound. So, you know, I may have to, you know, because I've really listened to a lot of music, and I actually looked into a lot of music, right? So I look into, hey, where did techno come from? Where did house come from? What was the first, you know? So, you know, that's the sort of thing that I look at always. And then even outside of that, because it's culture, I look at what were the conditions that caused this to be, right? So why did the people come from Mississippi and go wherever? Or how did the people end up in New York? What cultures came together in New York? So that's, you know, all that plays into their hip-hop even being invented, and, you know, me being able to listen to DJ Screw, I guess.
And just confirm it.
And yes, Ms. Blackbuster D said it was Detroit. So, Ivory Harris says Soulja Slim to me is the second best rapper from Louisiana, right after Lil Wayne. Huh, that's interesting. Oh, Rodney Bell says I was thinking Army, you went to fight. Nah, I was in the Marine Corps, and I did go to Iraq. Yeah. Cassette Coast, thank you so much. He has donated. He dropped a super chat. I really, really, really do appreciate it. He says, thanks for the great content and responding to all of our messages. Yeah, I try to do that. Also, if you notice on the videos themselves, I heart every single one that I read. And I don't just go down a list and click. I respond to a lot of them. And if I don't heart it, it's because if I go to sleep and I wake up and there's a whole bunch of them, I'll just read through them really fast, you know. So that's probably a reason why your comment didn't get hearted. But I read through basically every single comment at this point. The Society UK says, I thought Magic was a real good artist. So did so many other people. And then his voice was great. It seemed like Magic, if you're talking about Mr. Magic from No Limit, Magic was there to replace Skullduggery, is what it seemed like. I don't know why, but they seem very similar to me, even though they might not be, but yeah. Oh, Kraftworks. Do you mean like Kraftworks from the other side of the ocean with the K? Because they dropped some hard stuff, but I'm sure it was probably used a lot. Just like New Orleans Bounce uses the Showboys and Brown Beat a lot for their stuff. We could get into the house music and, you know, that sort of stuff that was used up north a lot of the time. VP says house music started in Chicago. Yeah, but when I think of house music, I also think about like techno, which is not basic, is really not the same as we think of it now. So, you know, there was these kind of concurrent movements going on where you had that house of Chicago and, you know, what I would call house of Detroit, which is what we may call techno. Ivory Harris says, Heit, what is your all-time favorite No Limit album? So, I don't know, but I've been thinking about this already. And I just say, See Murder, Life or Death. And one of the reasons for that is it was my actual first compact disc that I owned personally. So, and the songs on there were so hard. So, like, that, it had some really good production on that. So, yeah. So, VP says, best channel on YouTube. Thank you a lot. I really appreciate it. And people always say that. And I'm just like, wow, that's so crazy. I never imagined that people would think of something that I created as that. I really do appreciate it. And you say that, but I still try to not get stagnant and try to make better and better content. So this is in its infancy, still under construction. We will get even better. Rodney Bell, that damn house music had my country ass trying to do the percolator. More on that. So culture-wise, right? I didn't know about the percolator. I had no internet, nothing. Some guys moved down from Chicago where I was staying. If you're from Lake Charles, I was over there on 18th Street. Some guys moved down to the projects from Chicago, and they had me all like this and stuff. And I was like, I didn't know what I was doing, but they used to always be like, time for the percolator. And I'm like, oh, I'm over here percolating. I never even heard the song. But when I got the opportunity, I made sure I searched that out. And like a military story. In boot camp, it was this guy, you know, in, you have like these, you have, you know, those people who are like, yeah, this is my culture. And then you have the ones who are like, hey, I know these famous people, right? Because that's anytime. Like my glory story is, hey, I performed and opened up and met all these people from Houston who you know about, from, you know, Suave, not about to say Suave House, not Suave House, Swisher House and the SUC and stuff, right? So it's this guy, he had this little picture of Polaroid, so you know it's legit, with a skinny Trina, young Trina on it. He was from Miami. He was like, yeah, my brother dated Trina or whatever. And we're like, oh, cool. So, you know, it was those little things. And then, you know, we would have, he would like do peanut butter jelly dance. And we would sing the song. So people who have never heard this song, he's teaching us his culture of Miami hip hop, right? So you had people from all over, different backgrounds, different races, you know, be singing a peanut butter jelly time, right? Who've never heard the song because we didn't have music in boot camp. And he would do the peanut butter jelly. Like he'd be doing, I don't know if that's the name of the dance, but he used to do that style of dance. So this is like those things that you get in the military that you can't get anywhere. You accessing people culture that you haven't even experienced firsthand. So I felt that same way when I thought I was doing a percolator after not even hearing the song.
When you say percolator.
Rodney Bell say, bro, don't say that no more. I almost stood up. Uh-oh, it's time for the percolate. It's time for the percolate. Yeah. Who's seen that video that gets shared around every once in a while? There's a guy and there's a woman who try to get down to the percolator. Yeah. Ivory Harris says, what Lake Charles rappers making noise right now? Okay, so of course this is all going to be from me not being in Lake Charles right now and me having my preferences. You have GCC, who had the song Lovely Day. You have the people who I like. You have Young Jizzle. You have Mr. Chris, who else I listen to? I don't know. That's all I can think of right now. I'm going to have to make lists. You know, my memory is not all that great, like I mentioned earlier. Demand says, Hype Man, your movement is incredible. This is really blowing up. I was like, what movement? You mean my percolator? This is really blowing up. I can see this being a really big movement in the next 2 years, all the way from Jackson, Mississippi. Navy over here. Oh, that's what's up. Thank you a lot. We'll see where this goes. I will continue to make these videos and do this. And we're coming up on an hour and a half. Wow. I did not know it would be this long. But you're making some really great comments. And just like you say that I take you down memory lane, y'all do the same thing for me. Like, I just think of all this stuff from your comments, and then we can exchange culture. So, Miss Black Buster B, Miss Black Buster D, hey, Heit, check out DJ Snowflake. He took a sample from the Godzilla movie and made a beat. I'll see. Matt Truth, what you think about OG Ron C? So, I think it's cool. Like, what he done? So, you know, 5,000 watts, Ron C, you know, you had DJ Screw, and you, if you're doing something that's great, you're not going to be the only person in town, no pun intended. You're not going to be the only person in town. People are going to try to do what you do. It just happens. Like, what if the certain little group in New York, you know, you had your DJs and you had your MCs, and let's say you had some breakers, right? You just had those people and no one else tried to do what they did. We would not be here live on YouTube right now. So I'm glad OG Ron C took it further, because who would have done all the slow to chop stuff after Screw died nationwide? Mark Reed, you ever heard of Natchitoches? If I can pronounce it almost correct, then I think I heard of it. Yeah. Ivory Harris, Mia X in my top 5 female rappers of all time. Yeah, Mia X went hard. She always get mentioned. Every live video, someone is going to bring up Mia X. DMD4444 says, Cherie, you said you're from Chicago and Heidi's from LC. So how did you guys first meet? Texas. We're in Texas right now. Mark Reed. Yeah, so like, all right. One thing I didn't mention on the subject of military is military brats, right? People who grew up with their families in the military or some way serving the military, they move around just like others, right? And they may not have that same sort of home culture that a lot of people have really young, or depending on how long the parents were in, but they're absorbing all this culture from different places. And, you know, a lot of their friends are probably going to be also military brats, I guess you call them, from time to time. You know, maybe that's changing, but they're going to share that same sort of thing too. So, you know, the same with just migration in life. People end up in, you know, close in proximity. Yep. Mark Reed says, Zero shut Michael Watts down. I don't know about that. He definitely talked about him a lot. Society UK says, my first ever slowed down CD I bought was by OG Ron C. Southern Finest. Yes, so see, that's one thing. So we have my brother, the Society UK from the UK, obviously. And what he said was he got introduced to all of this through Lil Flip. And I hope you don't mind me sharing your story. And we talked about this on Discord. So y'all make sure when you get a chance to join that Discord channel. He talked about all this on Discord. These are the kinds of conversations I love to have. He heard about this stuff through Lil Flip, right? So we could write off all this stuff. You could say Lil Flip, a horrible rapper. Why would anybody listen to Lil Flip? Why would you listen to Michael Watts? Why would you listen to OG Ron C? But how can sometimes a person would never get to DJ Screw or, you know, Jam Pony Express or whoever through other means, right? Like, somebody probably never heard of bounce music, but through the military, somebody was listening to Mystikal or the UNLV disc, right? And then, like, I'm sure I can't think of a direct example. I'm sure I came across certain types of music in different ways. One may be I did not know about 3-6 Mafia. That's a bad example. I can't think of an example. But just as an example, let's say nobody liked Yo Gotti or whatever. And the first time I heard about Memphis rap was through Yo Gotti. And then from Yo Gotti, I went to Play a Fly. And then from Play a Fly, I went to 3-6 Mafia, getting back to DJ Spanish Fly and Squeaky and 8-Ball and MJG, right? Like, if it wasn't for OG Ron C, then we don't know if, you know, even the names DJ Screw would have gotten as big, or if Houston would have even gotten the shine that it got if it wasn't for Swisher House with Michael Watts. It's crazy. Cassette Ghost says, I'll donate another $10 if you can find me the original dirty version of UGK's Take It Off. I don't even know if there is a different version. I don't know. So, I don't know what to tell you. I would love a donation, but I don't have the answers for you. That's cool. But I appreciate your donation already. I really do. So, I remember that time of, you know, when, you know, Dirty Money and stuff, when you had Take It Off and what was the other one? What was the song you just mentioned? Dirty Money and was it Take It Off? Oh yeah, he mentioned Take It Off. Take It Off. What was the other one around the time that came out? Y'all go to the comments. Let me know. What was the song that came out around that time of Take It Off? Because they both had those hard 808s in it. So we'll go on to y'all. Let me know what that is. Let me see it. Yeah, let me see it. Interesting, because I was thinking of Let Me See It, but I was thinking that's part of Take It Off. But to me, those sounded alike. Sort of like with So Real and Too Real, to me, they both were UGK, and they both were like, every time I think of one, I think of the other one. But yeah, so I don't know. I remember around that time, though, that I wasn't all into those songs. This, to me, was like pop UGK. And I was like, I don't know why they're making these songs like this. Like, this sounds a lot different, but I'm glad that they did it because it showed that they weren't stagnant and they were advancing, right? So the styles had to evolve sort of with hip-hop to be able to be, to get that national stage that they got because of doing that. So, yeah. Yeah. Pimp C. Take It Off, Chick. Yeah. Somebody say, it's on the computer screen. Astroworld was my first drive. Wow, Astroworld. So, what you call it? What is Astroworld? Did Travis Scott name his album Astroworld? And don't he have like an Astroworld festival with nobody from Houston on it? Has anybody out there listened to Travis Scott's album and do you like him? The Society UK, Rodney Benjamin, screwed for 14 years. First ever screw tape he bought was 3 in the Morning Part 2 Blue. Yep. So, one of the things I did, so, let me tell you a short thing about what happened. I started burning CDs, was selling those, I started slowing and chopping stuff, and then people knew about me. That's how I became the guy with the CDs in the bag with the afro in high school in Lake Charles, Louisiana. So I guess you have to wait till the documentary. Since somebody asked about doing a documentary, you have to wait until the Heit the Great documentary. Once we get 250,000 subscribers, we're going to start really advancing the Heit the Great documentary about me. Cherie has to work on that, so I'm going to be hands off. Yeah. Basically, you are a bootlegger. Yeah. Basically. Hey, you have to try to twerk it somehow. Have to get in there. All right, y'all. So, I really appreciate everybody coming out. I really want to thank the people who've donated on Super Chat. Michael Reyes, Mark Reed, Rodney Bell, Mark Beast, Johnny Rojas, Cassette Coast. Thank you all so very much for donating. Thank you, everybody who came in here and watched. I'll still be in here after this feed ends, so you can get your last comments in. Let me know what videos you want me to work on. Make sure you subscribe to my other channel. There will be a description after this video is put up. You can see all my links, the Patreon, my other channel, the Discord server. But after this, I will be in the Discord server. So we can keep the conversation going in the Discord server when you're done. So go ahead and join that Discord server. I'm probably in there right now. It probably says I'm online because I see that I have a notification. So I really appreciate it. If you haven't subscribed, go ahead and subscribe. Hit the bell. Everything. I really enjoy talking to you. And let me know if this is a good time or some other time. Hour 38. We went pretty strong. I appreciate it, though, everybody. Holla. It's Heit.